when talking about violence, it's always important to look at how physical and individualized violence can be a manifestation of a broader, more structural trend. And from the perspective of at least international organizations or any institution, I would suggest that it's important to look at the wider mechanisms that are basically contributing to violence. This convention, however, this draft convention, is really focusing on more of the individual level. So it doesn't look at necessarily at that sort of structural level, but it's important to see what the connections can be where it's possible.
Historic, the discussion when it resurfaced in the 90s, it was very much seen not only by women's rights groups, but also within the UN system, it was seen as a violence against women's issues. I think, again, the mistake was it was very much seen as an individual women's issue. Within that framework, the most sort of most concrete difficulty or the most concrete roadblock, if you like, that came in was when women's rights activists got divided over the issue of prostitution, whether prostitution per se is violence against women or is it a form of labor that some women engage in and therefore they are entitled to labor rights protection like any other women. So when these sort of stark lines of division, it kind of divided women's rights activists. It was very detrimental to the progress of discussion. However, what happened was when the UN Transnational Organized Crime Convention came in and when the Palermo Protocol came in with a new definition, it sort of, you know, it acted in a way as a distraction, because then the criminal justice framework became the prime or the more dominant framework.
Well, the answer is will be ambiguous. It's no and yes in a way. No, because as I mentioned before, it focuses really on individual level of violence. Yes, in a way, because basically it does create sort of a normative framework in which violence in the world of work and harassment in the world of work can be addressed with better clarity. But by and large, violence in the world of work, which are caused by factors which go way beyond what this draft convention actually mentions. There are at least three major areas of policies which tend to create basically spaces for violence to occur. Those are, in a certain way, we categorize them into economic, political ones, and in a way, collective psychological ones. On the economic front, it's the failure of economic policies to provide livelihood opportunities for all, and especially affecting women, is something which is quite important, because that basically leads to a certain level of job scarcity, unemployment, basically lack of livelihood options. And that has manifestations in terms of, for instance, people trying to find ways of taking control of their land or forest where they used to, for instance, make a livelihood. On the one hand, you have certain actors trying to take control of those lands. On the other hand, you have those who are resistance. So how is violence looked up in that type of framework? Is it the violence of those state actors or maybe sometimes economic actors who are trying to take those types of spaces and make it basically unavailable for different types of livelihoods? Or is it violence of workers trying to fight, or people who are living, depending on that, on trying to fight back? Similarly, if there's a process of unemployment where you have strikes, what is the violence? Is it the violence of people being basically left without jobs, or is it the resistance and so on? Is it the people who are displaced as a result of same sort of an agrarian crisis? Or the violence of the mass suicides that occur, bonded labor that occurs as a result of people looking for different types of jobs, not being able to find any options? So this is all related really to certain types of the economic policies which aren't able to provide for livelihood opportunities. The second sort of structural factor is really political, and it has to do basically with how labor markets are segregated and how you have a hierarchy that has to be created in order to justify the fact that some people will be able to access more resources, more jobs, and those who can't or won't be able to access that. And then for that to work, you need the politics of identity, which where segregation, stigma, and different forms of discrimination, which often can be gender-based because they're strongly relying on patriarchal structures, basically become the norm. And there you have basically at least three different types of policies, which often characteristic of this. One is the whole policy of deregulation of labor, particularly outsourcing, which means that in a certain way, you're pitting people who are migrants versus those who are willing to work for less because they're struggling to survive, and those who have protected labor rights, and yet because of the absence of economic their opportunities, the way this the outsourcing thing works is it creates tension between those, which often conflagrates into different types of violence. You also have situations where you have a normalization of discrimination and stigma, where for instance certain forms of work are either just not recognized at all, particularly affecting women, or you have partial recognition but with a significant discrimination in the way wages and social protection is attributed or not, and you know, gender pay gaps, an example of that. So, and then that also affects in a certain way mobility, with certain types of populations being able to move more freely while others, particularly women, are under all sorts of both normative and regulatory restrictions of their movement. So, and finally, the last and quite important aspect of this is really psychological. And this is really how all these, as I mentioned, these failure of economic policies, these sort of reorganization of hierarchies and labor market segregation create a crisis of expectations, particularly affecting men because of the loss of power, the loss of resources, because of the loss of social status. And this is not a way of justifying the violence happening, but it's just a description of the type of pattern that occurs, where as a result of this loss of status, there is the legitimization of certain forms of segregation. Then basically violence becomes possible. And you have, particularly for those who are weaker, these perceived as being weaker or on the side of those, you know, usually migrants, women, people from minority groups, which is subordination of these groups in the hierarchy is considered normal. And of course, any reaction can also be perceived as violence. And yet, in some ways, it may be illegitimate, depending on whose perspective you're looking at. And of course, these processes of failed, basically, this crisis of expectation can also lead to extremes where you have, you know, basically forced displacement of people or ethnic cleansing and so on. So I think it's important to place this in the background, because otherwise we tend to forget that, you know, violence is much more than simply the occurrence of, you know, some physical harm.
If we are trying to work on violence against women, we're trying to work on human trafficking, we need to look to economic policies, we need to look to the implications of deregulation, labor market segregation. We need to not allow what is defined as violence to be decided by those who have the most power.